Jane, welcome to the Democratizing SEO podcast. How are you doing today?
I'm very good, thank you. Yeah, this is a nice way to spend a Monday afternoon. So yeah, thanks for the invite.
It's Tuesday. But it's our Monday for those listening worldwide. We have
It's our Monday today.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your time today. Today we're going to talk about what influences journalists to cover a story, and who better to speak with than a PR person. Now, you're the CEO and founder of JBL, a digital PR and SEO agency. I would love to hear the story of you creating, founding this agency.
Yeah, sure. So it's been a bit of a journey, to be honest, because we didn't start out as a digital PR and SEO agency. We started just coming up to 10 years at the end of September, and we set up as a content agency. So we did everything under the sun. We did websites, we did graphic design, we did social media, content, ebooks, everything. And about nearly 6 years ago now, we got to the point where we were just fed up of doing a bit of everything. And we wanted to literally be like experts at one thing, do it really well, and be really proud of our work. So we made the big step to kind of get rid of all the other services and literally just focus on digital PR. And back then, it was digital PR was kind of really growing. It was kind of gaining some momentum within the industry. And it was just the perfect time really to do this. So we started from scratch with our team. We moved offices from Northampton to Manchester, where there's a lot more talent. And we basically started the agency from scratch. And we now have a team of just under 30. And that includes ex-journalists, we've got content writers, we've got the outreach people, we've got a data team, a design team, and obviously the content writers as well. So we've got everything kind of covered under one roof, plus the SEO team as well, that obviously kind of enhancing what we're doing over on the digital PR side.
You say you're approaching your 10th year. Happy birthday in advance.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a chunk of my life. It's quite scary.
Now, when some SEOs think of digital PR, they think it's all about links. From your point of view, what is digital PR all about?
Good question. So I think digital PR, the way I think about it, is it's a nice fusion of link building and traditional PR. Because we're using traditional PR techniques a lot of the time to build backlinks. And because we're kind of stealing from traditional PR as well to support SEO objectives, we have kind of additional benefits to that. And that's the brand awareness and building brand credibility, and also building trust now as well, not just with journalists and consumers, but also with Google following kind of the EAT update and things like that. So that's how I like to think of digital PR, that we're, you know, it's that fusion of traditional PR and also kind of SEO. So we're building those links and we're also building brands at the same time.
Every PR person I've worked with has always said to highlight the story, quote unquote, the story. The story is a crucial element of a PR campaign's success, I'm told. The story has to spark something within a journalist to make them want to pick up a campaign. What do digital PRs consider to be the story?
Good question. So I think the concept of a story is quite loose these days, but essentially it's your pitch. It's kind of what you're putting into this pitch. And really, when we talk about the story, we're talking about kind of what the angle is. So what are we trying to get across? What are we trying to convey to the journalist? What are we trying to get the audience to feel? And what do we want out of this? So there's a lot that goes into that story. But I think just by putting a pitch together doesn't automatically give you a story too. Because it just could be a piece of content at the end of the day that you're putting in front of a journalist. And I think it's that kind of extra bit of work to put a story together and to package it up nicely for journalists to give them everything they need to kind of run with it.
Wouldn't the story change per journalist then? Would that mean you'll have to create a sort of package that's specific to the journalist your one is targeting?
It depends on what you're pitching. So sometimes we might be pitching a campaign. We might be pitching a particular angle of that campaign. So we might be talking to finance journalists, for example, in which case your pitch can be very similar to a lot of those journalists if they're going to similar titles. So say, you know, you're pitching to national media, then unless you're pitching to them exclusively, then you'll probably be sending them the same story or something very similar. Or you might swap out kind of headlines so that they're more appropriate for that publication. So it depends on what you're trying to achieve. So if it's exclusive and you want it to just, you know, be featured in The Guardian, The Times, or Forbes, or whatever it might be, then you'll pitch it just for them. And that will be unique to them. And then you can go out to the media later on with a version of that, but not exactly the same thing. So it depends kind of who you're talking to and what the relationship is and what you're trying to achieve as well. But generally, your pitch will probably stay the same, but you might tweak your headlines, you might tweak your intro copy, so it's relevant to the journalist you're pitching to and the publication and their audience. And then also you might change the data depending on, you know, what might be most relevant to which publication.
When I think of a pitch to a journalist, I think, okay, we have to give something to a journalist that they would want for their audience. It's like the traditional, yep, or if you like, old school marketing approach, yep, where you give, you know, a product, you give a blogger two products, one for them, one for their audience as a giveaway. Mm-hmm. When, yeah, one is pitching the story, are PRs normally targeting the audience? Sorry, the journalist or the journalist audience?
It's a good question. So usually you'd be writing for the audience. However, what you're pitching needs to be relevant to what that journalist has covered before. So there's no point sending a story that journalist would never cover to them, even if the audience might be similar. Does that make sense? So there is a lot of work that goes into finding the right journalist, because if you find the right journalist, you're much more likely to get their story covered rather than doing a blanket to, you know, lots of or hundreds of journalists that it might not be relevant to. And the tone of voice might not be relevant as well. And that's really important.
So the million-dollar question then, why do some stories get picked up and others don't?
Yes. So there's so many variables within this. So it's really hard, right, to kind of give one answer. And you might send the perfect pitch out, but it might not get picked up. So it can be dependent on how competitive it is for the journalist's time, how many other similar pitches they receive that day. It might depend on how quickly you get that pitch to them. So say there's some breaking news, within financial services, for example, and you're pitching a finance journalist, their aim will be to cover that story as quickly as possible and get comments or data from brands, etc., to kind of add more of a picture, create a bigger story. But if you haven't got that pitch to the journalist within a very quick timeline, then you're probably not going to get covered. So it can be, you know, 30 minutes to an hour, our aim is to get kind of pitches out to get breaking news covered. So that, yeah, news jacking has to be so quick these days because it's so competitive.
That's pretty much almost in real time.
Yeah. It's challenging for most brands.
The term picked up and viral stories, are these the same thing or very, very different?
No. When I say picked up, I just mean a journalist might look at it and think, yes, I'm going to run with this story, or I'm going to run with this quote or opinion or whatever it is. When we're talking about kind of anything going viral, we're talking about it really gaining momentum in the press and maybe on social media as well. And everyone starts talking about it and then it gets added to and it just kind of has this life of its own. But a campaign can get picked up by one publication, but you wouldn't say that gone viral by any means.
Right. Got you. I imagine it's a very much a relationship based or relationship building type of business. Do you ever reach a point where you can anticipate what a journalist is going to cover or is going to want to cover?
Yeah, sometimes it's not all about the relationships you have with journalists. I mean, it certainly helps, but you can't just rely on those relationships. But sometimes you can get a feel for how a journalist might react to a story, how they might react to what you're pitching to them. And then, you know, if you develop that relationship, what you often find, if you're giving them really great information, it's reliable, it's credible, etc., and there's decent expert-backed opinions and there's data, etc., then they will come to you when they need things. And that's the holy grail. That's where you want the relationship to be, where you've built that credibility, you've built that trust with them, and they contact you. That's the best way around. But it takes a while to generate that relationship.
You have a brilliant post on your LinkedIn. You say, how do you know your PR is gaining traction when journalists contact you?
100%. Yeah. And that's the way around we like it. And our team have got some very strong relationships with journalists, both in the UK and the US. And we don't rely on these for everything, because obviously there's different journalists for different sectors, and you know, we occupy quite a few different sectors that we kind of specialize in, but yes, it's a great feeling when a journalist contacts you and says, look, I need this, have you got anything, can you offer me any expert advice, have you got any data for this, any tips you can give me? And a lot of the time they need something in a hurry as well. So what we like to do with our clients is have like a bank of content, and that can be like any data, it can be like tips, advice, opinions, anything that we can offer that's already been signed off, so we can respond to that journalist immediately and go, yeah, this is what we've got, you know, hope that's helpful, let us know if you need anything else, kind of thing. Because when it comes to kind of newsjacking, or when they need to run a story really quickly, often you don't have time to get in touch with the client and to ask them if they can sign something off that you've written on their behalf, etc. So we like to have this bank of content that has already been signed off, that we know is safe to use, and then we can go out with it immediately.
A bank of content, it seems to me as though it's something that one needs to build over time and needs to be very much proactive in building over the weeks, months, and even years, correct?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it doesn't need to be done so much over years, but certainly kind of as your relationship, kind of as an agency, as your relationship builds with a client, and you create more and more content, you have more conversations with them, you see what campaigns they're running as well, you get a feel for what they're happy to cover, what isn't safe, etc. And as you kind of create more content and they've signed it off, you then end up with all this content that's kind of safe to use. So you can take bits and pieces from that. Or when we start working with a client, we'll ask what data they have, what experts they have internally, who we can have access to, and then we can start to kind of build that kind of bank of content that we can kind of tap into when we need.
A couple of years ago, there was this big push around big data, and it was almost, I remember there almost being within the SEO industry, a battle between quote unquote big data versus telling a story. And traditional marketers focus more on telling a story, saying this is the key to success in marketing. Whereas big data was, no, it's all about data. The more data you have, the better. incidentally, a lot of people pushing big data were those data companies, those big data companies. But that aside, do you think big data is a lazy way of someone being able to tell a story from a PR point of view?
It depends what you do with it, really. It really depends how much you have, what you've done with it, whether you've pulled out as, I mean, there's something to be said for having a lot of data for a big hero campaign, for example, because if you've got big data and you've collected it for a good reason and it complements each other, then that's great. As long as you're using it thoroughly and you've mined all this data for all the angles possible, because the more angles you have, the more you can be pitching stories to different types of publications. So we, for example, we did a campaign for money.co.uk around the impact of buy now, pay later schemes. And there was a lot of data that we generated from that. So what we had to do is decide which elements of the data we could use, which suited different types of publications, kind of from finance to mental health, whatever it might be, because the impact of buy now, pay later can be devastating for people if it gets out of hand. So I think if you're looking deeply into this data and you're carefully looking at it and mining it for different angles, and your data kind of backs up these stories, then I think that's great. However, you can also have too much data, not know where on earth to start, and then just get bogged down in it. So I think depending on how much time you have as well, sometimes a small amount of data can have the same amount of impact too. And it's the quality of that data, how unique it is, how new it is, if it taps into kind of trending stories. That can be more effective than having loads of data that may be slightly out of date or isn't that relevant to who you're pitching it to. So yeah, it's timing, it's your resource as well, so how much time you've got to spend with it. I mean, you could spend weeks and weeks looking at data, gathering angles and stories, etc., and then not have the time to do all the outreach. So it's one of those things. So that's why I say you can start with a small amount of data, and then if you need to add to it, you can.
Yeah, this big push around data came about with the rise in the use of infographics and SEOs. Yeah. You know,
we were part of that. I remember that well.
When we latch onto something, we tend to perhaps overdo it, some would say. And this just led into a flood of infographics across the web. And some of them were great with data. Yeah. Others were not so great.
Yeah, I mean, we started our careers kind of in the agency doing infographics, and then we were doing interactive infographics as well, so making the data more interesting and more and gamifying it and things. Amazingly, there's still a lot of infographics out there, and they still seem to be picked up and things, which is obviously great because it's a really nice way of visualizing information. A lot of campaigns still kind of hinge on these like really nice creative infographics. So yeah, they're still doing something.
Use them wisely, I always say.
Yes, and not for the sake of it. Campaigns. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I always encourage clients, stakeholders to contact or engage with SEOs early. I use the entertainment industry for illustration. The best campaigns are ones that are planned in pre-production. If you wait until just before launch for a campaign involving SEO, it's already too late.
Yep.
When should a stakeholder engage with a digital PR for a campaign?
Oh, at the beginning. Literally right at the beginning, before you've even decided what to cover or what your campaign is going to be about, because there's so much information and ideas that a digital PR can support with, and how we can improve on what you might already have as well. So you might have a great idea, but you might not have thought about all the opportunities around it. Whereas they might get a digital PR in towards the end when they're ready to go to the press with it, when they've got all the content together. But then they might be missing opportunities, you know, for further stories or for reaching different kinds of publications, and really getting the most out of that content too. I think we're all very guilty of creating these big campaigns and then not investing as much time and resource into the promotion of them as we are into the creation of them.
Mm-hmm. And when you say, go ahead.
I was going to say, and also, you know, we can be suggesting kind of where to collect data from. So, you know, the most credible data sources and how to make that campaign timely as well. So what events in the year you can tap into, you know, if it's about kind of, you know, if you're an e-commerce brand, can you tap into Black Friday? You know, if you sell gifts, can you tap into Mother's Day? All that kind of thing as well. So you can make that campaign not just interesting, but give journalists a reason to kind of cover it today rather than in 12 months, for example.
If campaigns were in phases, pre-production, production, post-production, i.e. the marketing push, when is the beginning?
What, of digital PR?
Sorry, I mean of the beginning. When you mentioned contact, digital PR, the very beginning, when in those three different phases is the very beginning? Is it in the pre-production or whilst mm-hmm. production is ongoing?
Pre-production. The moment you know you want to create a campaign and you have an idea about what that campaign should involve, that's the time to get, you know, any digital PR involved, so that they can help you out with the entire process. Because we don't just actually, you know, outreach the content. Most agencies are involved in the creation of that content right from the start. So we tend to know what kind of stories are going to land, what kind of content works best, how journalists want to receive it, how you can optimize that content for search and for PR purposes. So it just joins it all together. And it's just, yeah, so there isn't any kind of time wasted as well.
Why do you think some stakeholders fail to engage with digital PR at this stage, this pre-production stage, this ideal stage?
I think it's a good question, and I think it depends who it involves. And sometimes people worry about other teams treading on their toes, things, you know, maybe changing as a result of involving other people in the process. However, I've also worked on campaigns where other stakeholders within the business haven't been involved in the pre-production or the planning of that campaign. And then, you know, for big brands, it can get to kind of the point where they're ready to kind of sign off the content. And then they're like, right, this needs to go to compliance to check that, you know, it's okay from a legal perspective that we talk about this. And by then it's far too late. And, you know, they might cut down your content considerably and say, well, we can't talk about that. We're not happy. We don't feel safe talking about that. We don't want to use that bit of data for this reason. And you can end up with a fraction of your original campaign. You can lose all your angles. It can just change the whole nature of it. So although you don't want, you know, a campaign by democracy, for example, you don't want everybody to kind of have an opinion, it is worth getting, you know, PR, marketing, SEO, and people from compliance involved. So compliance, for example, can say, don't go near these topics because they will never get through. You'll never get that campaign launched. And then, you know, SEO can add their advice on optimizing it, etc. PR can own kind of the brand, the messaging, the tone of voice, etc., to make sure they're happy with it. And the SEO team are going to get out what they need from it, in terms of kind of hitting their objectives. So although it can be a little bit of a struggle, it's well worth doing that at the start.
Yeah, totally. I remember working for a finance brand, and we had this SEO slash digital PR campaign all ready to go. And the final stop was compliance, and they literally shut the entire thing down. And it was quite a timely piece, so it was such a an annoyance and a hard lesson to learn. And the lesson was to get compliance involved earlier, right from the briefing. And it's funny I asked that question, and always suggest that marketers get SEOs involved early, but I, as an SEO, didn't get another department involved early. So it was quite a hard pill to swallow, and explaining it to my
It
boss wasn't fun. Always get compliance involved early.
Even if they kind of rain on your ideas, etc., if you can agree one idea that everybody's happy with before you start kind of content production, that's going to save kind of so much time. And like you say, a campaign not going ahead at all.
Yeah, totally. I'm sure you get this question all the time, but I have to ask, what does success of a campaign look like?
It depends who you speak to. So it depends on the objectives of the brand. It depends in SEO. But I mean, there's some popular or most the most common kind of KPIs that are looked at from an SEO perspective in terms of like the quantity of backlinks, the quality of those backlinks, and the relevance. And then you've got, whether those campaigns drive any referral traffic. Obviously, increases in keyword rankings, etc., and seeing kind of shifts in visibility overall as well. But it predominantly tends to be looking at link KPIs, so quantity, quality, relevance. But I'm happy to say that there's a lot more focus on the quality of backlinks and the relevance these days. And we've had quite a few brands come to us recently because they've been hit by the Google spam link update. And their traffic's just dropped off a cliff. So they're having a panic and they need kind of decent backlinks, immediately. And obviously they don't want to kind of go paying for, low quality links anymore.
The term cost per link is a very interesting one for me, because I'm one for hard metrics, right? I get it. I don't shy away from hard metrics, especially because I've worked in industries where they literally don't mince their words, right? Finance, gambling, those sort of industries. But some wise so-and-so decided one day, actually, cost per link should be a metric. And I'm sure a lot of people relate to this as a big issue, because if you track the cost per link over time, you'll see it's increased significantly for various reasons, including publishers realize actually this is actually a revenue generating scheme for, or scheme's probably not the right word, but venture for us, right? So they then work on setting their rate card for these sort of things, and the cost per link continues to grow to increase. Do you find it's better for stakeholders to avoid these sort of hard metrics, because it leads to bad things?
Oh, it's a tricky question. And I'm not sure there's kind of one answer to it, but I think it's the easiest
Let me
way for
rephrase
the
it slightly.
industry.
Yeah, let me rephrase it slightly. Would you prefer stakeholders didn't use cost per link as a metric?
Yes, however, I don't know what else they would use as a cost metric, and they've got to be able to decide how they measure value. And so cost, if you've got an agency like us that, you know, we guarantee to build organic links, never paid, always earned. And the way that guarantee works is that, you know, at the end of, you know, a period of time, if we haven't hit that minimum link KPI, then we'll do another campaign for free until we do. So we're very good at not having to do additional campaigns because we hit our link KPIs. However, I don't agree to anything that's, you know, completely unrealistic, because I don't want to put that pressure on our team either. But we have to be able to say, this is the volume of links that you can expect for this spend. And then automatically you end up with a cost per link. If I was guaranteeing organic traffic, for example, or some kind of increase in rankings, which I can't do, then it would be cost per, you know, X increase for, you know, X keyword or whatever it might be. But we don't do that because obviously that's a lot harder. So you're just left with kind of cost per link, really, because that's very tangible, very specific, and it's controllable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If we were to put that aside, right, and say, okay, this is one metric to define success of a campaign.
Yep.
What other metrics should stakeholders be considering?
That's a good question. So as an agency, we've done a lot of work on how we measure the success of campaigns ourselves, because we're aware that there's a lot more pressure on SEOs and PRs to be able to show the value of digital PR and link building. And so we're looking at a wider range of metrics. So we've got a range of SEO metrics, which I've just mentioned, and then we've also got the PR metrics. So we're looking at kind of whether we're getting the key messaging within that coverage, how, you know, whether our client is the only brand mentioned in that article, obviously anchor text, etc., and then any other, and whether there's an expert from that brand that appears in that coverage, because then we're building credibility, we're positioning, we're doing kind of the traditional side as well as the SEO side. But we're also starting to look at metrics like share of search as well, so how the brand is performing compared to competitors. And that gives a much better illustration of where that brand sits with their competitors and, you know, the distance between them a lot of the time. And it gives you something tangible to work towards, either, well, obviously increasing your share of search from a brand perspective, potentially overtaking competitors, or bridging that gap between them. So theirs comes down and hopefully kind of yours goes up, etc. It's also indicative of how that brand is performing generally as well, not just from a digital PR perspective and link building, but how well known that brand is, you know, and whether that's increasing or decreasing. And if it's decreasing, then we know that you're in a worrying position as a brand, and you need to invest much more heavily in organic in order to build that share of search up.
I think that as share of search is a metric that's going to increase in popularity within the industry, SEO and digital PR. Within SEO, you know, you have AI in search, you have Google search, SGE, search generative experience, right? Yeah. And these are things that are drastically changing search as an industry. And there is this impact on rankings, which is a big question mark, because SGE, from the look of it, seems to be something that's going to eventually eradicate the traditional 10 blue links as we know it, which means the traditional rankings, the recommendation side of search, will pretty much evolve out in the years to come. We still have time, but given how radical this year alone has been, we can only expect the next years, the next year and so to come, to be potentially drastically, increasingly, what's the word? It will change quickly. That's what I'm trying to say. If all of this is true, where does this leave rankings and links? Because essentially the whole idea of links, you know, I'm sure, you know, 10 or so years ago, links were synonymous with SEO. Everyone carried out link building because it was known as what SEO was, and it was simpler to explain to non-SEOs. And that, of course, led to an increase in rankings. If rankings are going away, and I'm aware that no one has the answer to this because we're all waiting to see what Google does. But what do you anticipate happening within the industry if rankings were to be a non-factor in the years to come?
If that happened, obviously that's a huge shift. And as a digital PR agency, if there were no rankings anymore, then there wouldn't be that need to build backlinks. However, there will always be a need for PR. I don't see that ever going away, traditional PR. And just because the way search is evolving, I think, you know, search engines would then be reliant on traditional PR and, you know, using that as a factor in itself. And I think backlinks can be a bit crude as a ranking factor on their own, particularly because of the way you can kind of manipulate it and you can buy them and all that kind of thing. But when they're used properly with digital PR and you're actually pitching good quality content, there's experts behind that content that Google can see, I don't think that side of it will be going anywhere. And I think there'll always be a need for expert-led, experience-led content. And I think the challenge will be to discern what is AI driven and what isn't AI driven. And that's where traditional PR comes back in. And I think that's why I think that's not going anywhere. And that's really important because there'll always be a need for that. However, it will be interesting to see how search evolves, but I don't expect rankings to go anywhere, particularly overnight. And I think it's very easy to, this might happen. And it is evolving really quickly. However, I doubt, you know, there's all these websites are built on kind of backlinks and the other factors. So to take that away overnight, what would happen to the internet and to rankings? And no one would know where things are. SEOs would come in the morning and be like, well, what do I do now? You'd potentially be wiping out so many jobs that I think Google's very aware of as well. But I think that their updates recently are all about quality and relevance and looking at experts and experience. That's what they care about. So I think, you know, you can do these lovely kind of fun campaigns and stuff, but they won't lend themselves to building credibility and all that kind of side of things, which will always be required. So, yeah, does that kind of answer that question?
Yeah, it's one of those ones where so many factors can impact the industry. And another factor which I'm personally very invested in is the factor of TikTok as a search engine. I don't know if you use TikTok much, but I use it just as a personal use, but also studying it because I've said this for going on 2+ years now. I do think they are a legit threat to Google. Their For You page is excellent as a social media platform, but it's more, the platform is more than a social media space now. They're building out their search space, and they've recently just updated it to have a shop, if you like, page, similar to their FY For You page. And all of this to me is them slowly getting into acquiring users to search on the platform rather than to exit it and carry out the search on Google, which to me is them influencing Google to make the changes that they are making, especially with stuff like SGE perspectives, even Bards to some extent. And I'm very interested in whether SEOs would now be platform specific SEOs, and if PR folks will carry out PR, digital PR per platform. Do you how does this feel to you, all of these changes that are happening?
I think what I'm not a fan of is saying one thing is going to happen, TikTok is going to take over, there goes Google, etc. I think, you know, obviously it's a challenger in terms of kind of, you know, how you can search on it, what it offers, etc. And the experience is obviously very different, a lot more engaging. However, it's still for, a specific demographic, although that is changing. However, I think you'll always need Google to service everybody, because if you start out as a social media network, yes, you can grow, you can adapt, you can tweak, etc. But will you ever capture everybody? I don't know. There would have to be some really interesting marketing done to capture the older generations as well. But however, having said that, we use TikTok from a digital PR perspective to look at what's trending, what we can, to create stories around, to debunk things that are, there's so many people claiming to be experts on TikTok that clearly aren't experts. A lot of what they're saying is utter nonsense, but it gives us loads of ammunition to go to journalists and be like, this is incorrect. So who's going to decide what's correct and what's incorrect? So would you be able to use it in that respect, like you can use Google to actually kind of offer you the best advice rather than just kind of what's most popular? It's an interesting one.
Yeah, and I think Google leaning on their EEAT aspect is key for them, because people, the more they spend their time on TikTok and realize actually these folks are just not really credible at all, the more they're likely to stick or return to Google. And this battle that seems to be happening I'm completely glued. It's my entertainment to some extent, because it's just
your reality TV. Captivated.
Yes. I'm completely captivated by it. Jane, you seem to have such a joy for PR. What attracted you to it in the first place?
Good question. And actually, I kind of fell into it. It was more accidental, and it was because we were creating these infographics, and we were started creating interactive infographics, and then we started doing the outreach for these interactive infographics, and then it just kind of evolved from there. And then we were doing, full-on data-led campaigns and all kinds of things. And then just slowly we've, done a lot of work to tap into the traditional PR side as well, because we don't just do hero campaigns for link building. We also have objectives that are linked to PR as well. So we have, specific objectives to help reposition brands as well as build backlinks and really kind of build credibility. So if you've got a brand that's new to the market, then not only do they need backlinks, but they need to build that brand awareness. We need to get them as much traction as possible so that they can compete with, much bigger brands that have been out there for years and years. And you can do that with digital PR. So that's why I love digital PR as kind of a channel and as a technique, because it does both these things. Whereas I think kind of traditional link building is just about building links. It's about kind of quantity, etc., and occasionally about quality. And then when you fuse the traditional PR with it, you end up with this much better quality product So you're building links and you're building kind of brand awareness as well. And obviously with that, credibility and trust. So it, there's just additional benefits, I think.
10 years in, what keeps you in digital PR or PR overall?
I think the changes are really interesting. And each, I mean, because I do the sales as well. So I'm very involved in the sales and the pitching and things. And the briefs that we have coming in, some of the challenges that brands are facing at the moment, there's, you know, there's so much competition out there, both from a digital PR perspective, and from a brand perspective. A lot have been hit by updates and their rankings of suffering. So we're also not doing emergency care for brands, but we're also kind of helping them get back on their feet from being affected by, you know, various updates and things. So that's exciting. And then just seeing the team evolve, seeing kind of the new techniques come through, and just how good my team are at building really good quality and relevant links. And I'm so glad we're moving away from quantity generally as an industry. And I have more and more conversations about quality and relevance. And that's really interesting to see that shift in perception and for people to realize actually just a few powerful links can have a really good impact and drive kind of referral traffic to product pages, etc. And people can even see, you know, conversions off the back of that as well. Then that's amazing. So I think digital PR link building have come a long way. We've still got some work to do. There's still a lot of education to do out there about the pros of digital PR compared to kind of more pure link building. But yeah, it's just an exciting industry in general. And all these additional changes with TikTok and AI and everything just make everything a little bit more interesting, but also challenging.
Yeah, it's a evolving industry that keeps one on their on their toes.
Yeah.
Lastly, if every brand knew this about PR, they would see an increase in business. What would this be?
That there's so much internal expertise that they could be using to generate PR coverage and backlinks quite easily. And, you know, just tapping into that and, you know, just talking to everybody that works in the business. And there's a lot more personal branding going on as well. And that really plays into things. And journalists are looking for those experts all the time. And it doesn't have to be someone at the top of a business. It doesn't have to be the CEO. It can be somebody, you know, in the product development department or wherever it is. But just, yeah, using those experts internally, you'd be really surprised at what you can achieve, what they can tell you about your customers and ideas for content that they might give you as well.
Well said, Jane. Where can people find you online?
They can find JBH at jbh.co.uk, and they can also come and check me out on LinkedIn. Just Jane Hunt on LinkedIn.
Awesome. I'll have those links in the description so people can
Perfect. Get in touch with you. Appreciate that.
Thank you so much for your time today, Jane. It's been wonderful speaking with you. Have a brilliant day. I'm sure we'll catch up again another time.
Thank you for having me. It's been really enjoyable.
Cheers. Bye now.